Hello and welcome to the National Security Conversation. The Indian military is reportedly undergoing several structural reforms that will have far-reaching consequences for the neighborhood, especially for Pakistan and China. The question is, how drastic are these reforms and whether they will be sufficient to meet the Indian strategic challenges in the neighborhood vis-a-vis Pakistan and China? And what does the first budget of Mr. Modi's second term offer for defense modernization in India? To discuss these issues, I have with me Mr. Saikat Dutta. Saikat Dutta is the South Asia editor at Asia Times Online and a strategic advisor at NullCon. He is an award-winning journalist with expertise in public policy, risk assessment and security affairs. Welcome to the NSC, Saikat.
Thank you.
Saikat, let me begin with the article that you wrote recently on Asia Times. You wrote in the article that India is undertaking major military reforms to enhance its capability to fight future wars, potential wars with China and Pakistan. What are these reforms that you're talking about in your article?
So, primarily, what has happened in India was that whatever structures they inherited were mostly colonial from the British. And if you look at the way they used to fight wars, the structures, etc., they had not really changed much in the last 70, 80 years. They used to think in terms of large formations, and some of the concepts of, you know, strike corps were almost as old as, say, the 1965 war, where they would always depend on armor, large formations, and try and exploit the lack of strategic depth in Pakistan, and also counter their army reserve north or army reserve south, etc. But during Op Parakram, which happened just after December 13th, 2001, when the Indian Army was asked to mobilize after the attack on the Indian Parliament, they realized that they were taking a far too long to mobilize their strike corps. And as a result, they were losing the element of surprise, and it was giving the Pakistanis enough time for them to get their defenses in place and move their structures in place. So they came up with what is now widely known, although not officially accepted, as the Cold Start Doctrine. But the doctrine also had many of its lacunae. So then again, they went back to the drawing board, and then they started looking at how can we improve the idea and the concept. And by the time they were looking at this, the Pakistanis had already come up with a counter offensive doctrine to counter what we call the Cold Start Doctrine. So they again went back to the drawing board. They again, the perspective planning.
Is that the full spectrum deterrence that you're talking about?
To an extent, but the idea was that how can we, the key part being that not only can we mobilize faster, but how can we also ensure that we have greater mobility for a smaller force without compromising on the firepower. So this is the kernel around which the whole new strategy is. And this will have far-reaching consequences, because you are not looking at a 70-year-old structure which you are essentially breaking from inside. And you are not sure when you are breaking something how good it will be when you rebuild it, because it will also have consequences for ranks, for the existing rank structure, for the kind of responsibilities you have, and a whole lot of new challenges. So that's why it's considered in some ways the deepest kind of reforms that they've undertaken.
So two questions on that, Saikat. One is basically, was there certain buy-in within the Indian military on this whole Cold Start Doctrine? Because many times you heard the army general saying that we don't have such a doctrine. So have you talked to many of these people, you've been covering these issues. Do you really think that there was a certain serious thinking within the Indian military on the Cold Start Doctrine?
So, you see, after Parakram, there was a committee set up under then Western Army Commander General J.J. Singh. Hmm. And if I remember correctly, I think it was a May 2004, if my memory serves me correct, the findings of that committee, which looked at Parakram and what went wrong, etc., were presented at our track in Shimla. And General N.C. Vij and then Vice Chief of Army Staff Shantanu Chaudhary and the DGMO, everybody was there. And that's when they started really looking at that, how do we take and learn the lessons of what went wrong in Parakram. So these are undeniable facts. And in fact, I remember I was with the Indian Express at that time, and I broke the story on the Op Parakram reforms and what needs to be done, so on and so forth. And then they decided that the best way to start looking at some of these issues is to deal with mobilization and how quickly we can mobilize and also increase the firepower of our existing strike corps. So some kind of new thinking did take place. They didn't give it a formal name, but this thinking was there for sure.
But why do you call this very fundamental? I mean, if I sort of understood you correctly, you're basically saying this is a very fundamental shift within the organizational structure of the Indian military, and this will probably have far-reaching implications for the military itself. Why do you say that? I mean, if this is something that has been going on for the last, say, 18 years since 01-02 crisis, why do you say, one, it's new, two, it will have far-reaching implications?
For the simple reason that they have not attempted this on ground so far. So the military also is deeply hierarchical. You have certain designations, you have certain ranks, you have certain positions. But because they're restructuring everything, for example, do we still fight as a division? Now, if you do away with a division or what used to be known as the idea of a division, you're also doing away with so many ranks which are basically major general ranks. Now, that for any military, which will, because more ranks also means more budgetary allocation, more positions for promotions, avenues, etc. All that is now being seriously challenged. And instead of looking at divisions, you're looking at smaller forces, which are much more mobile, but almost or equal amount of firepower that a division used to have. So those are creating fundamental changes, not only in terms of how many positions you will be left with or how many ranks you will be left with, but also in terms of command and control, that, you know, senior commanders in battle, what is the kind of forces levels they will be controlling and commanding? All that is changing, which for a traditional army like the Indian Army is a fairly deep change.
Would you then say that the post Balakot strikes, or even the surgical strikes post Uri in September 2016, these are probably the logical culmination of this kind of a thinking? Not probably in material terms, but certainly in, say, in terms of intent as to what the Indian Army wants to achieve vis-à-vis Pakistan.
Let me address Balakot and surgical strikes separately. Surgical strikes, if you were to look at it as a classic military maneuver, I wouldn't call them surgical. And a lot of generals who are serving in the Indian Army are also not calling it surgical, because frankly, the understanding in the literature of war, what is considered a surgical strike is very different from what was actually carried out.
Clearly.
Those were in some ways a very well coordinated series of cross-border raids, which usually most infantry battalions, and you spent a lifetime in those, you've seen those, what we call the Ghatak or commando platoons carrying out those kind of strikes. Yeah. The difference being these are better coordinated and happen simultaneously over a large area. So in terms of military doctrinal change, it didn't create much of an impact. But in terms of Balakot, there was a certain amount of thinking, because, I mean, we've always, when you look at India, Pakistan, and now China, we always look at the nuclear threshold, at what point the escalatory ladder could lead to an exchange of strategic or threats, if not actual weapons. So they were looking for a threshold which is slightly below and will not be so escalatory, but will also show a certain kind of kinetic action which will establish the intent of the government. So in that sense, Balakot introduced that new element. But if you were to look at how do we follow up on Balakot, they needed a lot of structural changes, because if the escalation were to, I mean, things were to rapidly escalate, how do you then either take advantage or have a formation which will offer a credible defense and therefore a counter offensive, etc. So all that thinking was already in place, and which is why this got a lot of impetus. And you were also looking at China in some sense, because earlier there was this thinking, again, the old thinking was, let's have a strike corps against China.
Let's come to China in a minute, but if I may go back to this issue of the new changes within the Indian military. So at the level of material changes, there are fundamental shifts taking place, as you said, and there are also probably taking place changes at the level of intentions, right? I mean, the Indian Army, or at least the Indian defense setup today, is more proactive. I wouldn't call it aggressive, but clearly more proactive than it used to be earlier. So this is perhaps the coming together of a new set of intentions and a new set of material changes. And you would call that really, really noteworthy.
Absolutely, because you see, you're now looking at much more offensive platforms. Like, for example, earlier, after Cold Start Doctrine, they, what used to be called the defensive corps, they started calling them pivot corps, that once the strike corps have managed to establish a certain kind of a beachhead and push through Pakistani defenses, then the idea was that the pivot corps, which are essentially in a defensive role, can then pivot around and also make use of the breach that the strike corps have established. Now they're thinking in terms of not having pivot cores at all. Instead, they're looking at what one realization was, that even pivot cores had a lot of offensive capabilities which were dispersed. But if we are able to then pick up those reserves and bring them into what they are now calling integrated battle groups, then what happens is the amount of offensive platforms or formations goes up dramatically.
So how does integrated battle group, IBG, give an offensive advantage to the Indian military compared to the strike corps or the pivot corps?
So first of all, they are much smaller.
Okay.
But so as a result, you know, if I were to use the analogy of a super tanker, by the time a super tanker decides to make a certain degree of turn or there is a certain amount of churn, then it takes a lot of time, there's a lot of calculation, there is a lot of calibrated movement before you're able to induce those changes, because it's a large, massive vessel, which was happening with the strike corps, which meant in terms of logistics, you had to put tons of things in place. Instead, they decided that can we therefore achieve a situation where we have much smaller forces, but they're extremely mobile, and mobility brings a lot of agility. So therefore, when you have a lot of agility, you're able to move much faster and exploit certain kind of advantages much quicker. As a result, they also decided that how do we concentrate and bring more firepower to these formations, because there was a lot of logistic support which would, so the teeth to tail ratio, as we call it, was much bigger there. Now that teeth to tail ratio is much lesser and more in favor of teeth than tail.
But how do the existing structures, for example, the strike corps or the corps commanders, be it in Srinagar or in Jammu, how do they manage these sort of integrated battle groups? Are they not under these corps? How do they operate?
So we have three strike corps, which is one used to be based out of Mathura, two corps which is based out of Ambala, and then 21 corps which used to be based out of Bhopal. So these were our three major strike formations. So what they are now looking at is, first of all, the first major change that has happened is all the offensive platforms or the offensive formations which are part of the strike corps are no longer in their old locations. All of them have been moved up, all of them. And this has been done systematically to ensure that they have even studied, for example, bottlenecks for mobilization. So not only are you looking at much less time for mobilizing, once you mobilize, they've also studied the areas which used to be traditional bottlenecks, and they've all moved ahead of those bottlenecks. So there are no bottlenecks left anymore as far as their planning is concerned. So whether it is by roadhead, because most of the
command and controls
have also moved up. So what used to be originally called formation, field formation headquarters or advanced formation headquarters, they have now become permanent headquarters. So while there is a command and control which will continue to exist in Ambala, in Mathura or in Bhopal, but those will be mostly for very, very limited kind of functions, and most of the other formations are already now much closer to the border than ever before.
Interestingly, you also mentioned earlier on in your answer that Pakistan probably has also taken some actions in order to address or counter some of the initiatives that India has undertaken over the years. What are some of those activities that you have noticed on the Pakistani side in terms of policy changes?
So interestingly, I met a former chief of general staff of the Pakistani army who, I can't identify him, but I met him at one of our meetings abroad, and he, without getting into too many details, did share the fact that he was one of those who wrote the counter doctrine.
I know who you're talking about, that's okay.
So he wrote one of the counter doctrines to the Cold Start doctrine. And I think a key part of that is when they brought in the tactical nukes or what they call the Nasser missile, and that their formations would then look at tactical nukes, because they started looking at Cold Start doctrine as a existential threat to Pakistan.
But does that really stand, that counter sort of action that Pakistan has taken of bringing in TNWs or Nasir, etc., looking at it from today, post Balakot, it looks as if those actions those activities are probably not going to have much of an impact on the Indian offensive strategy in future.
So from a practical perspective, and I completely agree with you when you say that those are not, but the fact is that they have a certain, and they think it's a credible counter to what the Indians have been building. But also interestingly, a large part of their force, for example, if you remember during the Kargil war, a whole lot of Northern Light Infantry battalions which we were at war with, And they were basically what we in India call them territorial army units. So they were their territorial army units. Similarly, a large component of the defensive forces are what we call Mujahid battalions, mm-hmm. which are in the non-JNK sector. Mm-hmm. So those Mujahid battalions are all being formalized and they are being now given the same kind of positioning mm-hmm. that their normal infantry battalions have. So there is a lot of formalization that is also taking place from a defensive posture that they are doing on their own. So this has also, in if not just the Nasser missile or just not the tactical nuke missiles, but they're also looking at in terms of actual formations which are now in better position with better firepower, with better defensive capabilities and a much more formal command and control than ever was to counter some of these offenses.
Let's shift to China. You did mention China. So how do these changes in India fare vis-a-vis the challenge posed by China?
So China again...
China has undergone several military reforms in the recent past, especially under Xi.
So if you look at what's happened in China is, first of all, the reduction in their actual ground troops has been tremendous, yeah. which is nobody thought that they would be able to do this kind of an exercise, but from all available studies and scholars and intelligence, they have undergone. What they've also gone through is they've gone through a fairly, I mean, what scholars say, a fairly traumatic phase in terms of, you know, suddenly building cross-functional capabilities. So suddenly a armored corps officer being asked to be an infantry officer, an infantry officer being asked to do logistics, etc. We are not very sure what they were trying to do, but I think in some ways they're trying to build the expertise and whatever reductions they're doing to have multiple capabilities in the kind of officers and the mm-hmm. kind of troops mm-hmm. that they have,
etc. Interoperability.
Which yeah. will build a lot of interoperability, or I would say the right word probably would be intraoperability, where you're able to do a lot of things depending on what kind of a situation. So they've also invested heavily in their special forces component, modernizing their air force. They're also looking at smaller, sharper, meaner platforms and formations, etc. So that's what been happening in China. The counter to that in India was that we should have a strike corps. But strike corps basically depend, which are offensive, depend on mobility and they depend on the kind of armor that you can carry, which frankly in the mountains don't make any sense. So they did come up with a strike corps which was approved by the government of India and the earlier government, and then they started, but there was very little budgetary support for it. And unfortunately, what happened was the army ended up asking for a lot of things that they wanted because they thought under the sanction they'll be able to get through a lot. So usually a corps has at least three divisions. In this case, the corps has come up with only one division, and as far as I understand, they don't plan to add two more divisions as was originally envisaged.
So what do you think are some of the shortcomings in the Indian military strategy or in terms of structures and strategies vis-a-vis China? I'm not more concerned about China than, say, Pakistan. So if you look at the Indian military strategy in terms of material capabilities, reforms and doctrines, what are the shortcomings vis-a-vis China?
So, and I'll restrict my comments to a purely military posturing. So first of all, if you were to continue with looking at how the strike force function, again, this is conventional military logic that while in the plains you need a 3:1 ratio of superiority, in the mountains that immediately goes up to 9:1. Plus your roadheads are not in good shape, and in the mountains warfare, high altitude warfare is very different from warfare in the, and you don't have the kind of mobility or the kind of armor that you could, except in very small pockets. Also the kind of terrain that we have, the places like the Siliguri corridor, which is always known as our lifeline to the northeast, and this is a particularly vulnerable area, which is why you can see why Doklam became such a major issue. We've had those traditional fears about the Chinese. I think one of the biggest problems we have is that our air force is not modernized enough to take on the Chinese in that sector, because when you're in high altitude, you always have the amount of payload that you can carry is very, very limited because the atmosphere is rarefied. So even if you have aircrafts up ahead, and now Tezpur, etc., do have air bases which have potent aircraft, but their ability to carry munitions, etc., is extremely limited. But I think even a bigger problem there is the kind of connectivity and the lines of communication, and the roads are in terrible shape. Also, look at the kind of command. So there's almost four Indian Army commands which are looking at the same threat. So imagine trying to coordinate between these four commands to fight, while what the Chinese have done is they have now consolidated everything into a single military region which looks at India when it comes to looking at us as an adversary. And the other major problem for us is, and these are, I'm just at the surface right now because there are much bigger problems. Mm-hmm. Our Air Force and the Army are not even sitting together. So for example, when you look at Eastern Air Command and when you look at Eastern Army Command sits in Fort William in Calcutta, while the Eastern Air Command sits in Shillong, and they are not even co-located. So you can understand, even if you're not even sitting together, how do you have joint planning? The Chinese have no such problems. They're completely integrated into theater commands, and they know what to do when the balloon goes up. We have not even begun to think on those lines.
So given these issues, what do you think are, or what do you think should be some of India's defense priorities at this point of time? In terms of, if you were to sort of write about it or tell the government that these are the things that needs to be done in the, say, in the next 10 years, what would those be?
So obviously the man behind the machine is very good when it comes to India, and if you see, India has come a long way from 62. So this is no longer the Indian Army of 1960. It's a well-trained and a very good fighting force, and even the Chinese would think a number of times before they would think of any.
But the man alone is probably not enough.
But the man is not enough.
Absolutely.
So the structures are not in place. So for example, you have to at least look at not four but only two, which is the Northern and the Eastern Command, looking at the whole border on their own. Lines of communication, for example, there is no connectivity which can go from Jammu and Kashmir right up to Arunachal, even though the terrain allows for that kind of connectivity, and a connectivity of that can hugely enhance your military offensive capabilities. Three, we need to have jointmanship in the real sense, in terms of something similar to a theater command, if not a full theater command, between the Air Force and the Army, because the primary offensive and the fighting will have to be done by these two forces. And then you also have to look at it in terms of mobilizing, because mobilizing in the mountains, especially in the Arunachal sectors, takes a huge amount of time and the lines of communication are really poor. So how do you then plan for those? And finally, the one thing that we need to do is we need much more scholarship, because right now our understanding of perspective planning, our understanding of threat assessment, I think is hugely outdated. And we are not being able to put our money in the capability, the captive capability that lies not only within the military but also outside the military. Like for example, the work you do and the work that the other think tanks are doing and the work that scholars are doing, all this needs to be coordinated and consolidated so that we have the best possible minds working on this. Because if we don't think this through right, we'll never be able to allocate the right amount of money or acquire the right kind of capabilities. So as a result, we will never have the best possible position to take on an adversary which is rising rapidly, which is China.
You've been looking at these things for some time now, and you're an outsider. You are not a former military officer or a former officer of any kind, for that matter. Do you think there is enough thinking happening within the system, say in terms of perspective planning or net assessment or etc. etc.? Or do you think there's very little of that happening?
I use a trick to understand whether that is happening or not. And whenever I see multiple organizations being set up to do the same thing, I think that's a fair indication of whether they are actually doing. So today, not only are the three services different in terms of their scholarship, whether they're whatever schools and schools of higher defense management exist, but you also see within the organization they are now creating. So you have a net assessment office, you also have a joint warfare doctrine office, you have different agencies trying to look at the same piece from different perspectives. While that may have certain advantages, but structurally we have only that many resources and that many bright minds. And if you start dividing them and pulling them in different directions, and there is no interface between the schools and the institutions which lie outside that ambit, there is no structural and institutional. As a result, it's a serious question, do we have the best minds? Because threat perspective planning, which is where you are, we getting the perspective right? Is it then translating into the Defense Acquisition Council? Is it then plugging into the operations directorate of the three or four services which need to work together? Is it building into the economic power we have, etc.? Now, these are very complex, and not complicated, but extremely complex studies that need to be done. And I don't think we are anywhere close to where we are.
In other words, while we may have undertaken some reforms vis-à-vis restructuring our defense etc., there is a lot more that needs to be done.
Oh, right? Absolutely.
What is your take on the latest budget allocation for defense?
So,
too little, too much?
I think we don't have a defense budget, because if you are not able to pay for acquisitions that you made few years ago, forget about new acquisitions. Do you really call that a budget?
Like, again, for example, explain that to our viewers. What does that mean?
So what has happened is, and this was a former, he's retired now, Lieutenant General Sharat Chand, when he was the Vice Chief of Army Staff. It's unprecedented that he went in front of the Standing Committee of Defense in Parliament and said, and the report is publicly available, that they don't have money. For the first time, the Indian military had not only run out of money for new purchases, they had also run out of money to pay for purchases which have already been committed to. So as a result, so in your budget, the key budget to look for is your capital budget, because that's where your money for modernization, etc., comes. And this time, our understanding is that even the interim budget, which has now gone into the formal budget, there is a huge gap, which is almost close to 50% of what is needed for your existing as well as new acquisitions.
So you're basically saying that the first defense budget of Mr. Modi's second term is a disappointment.
If you talk to the military veterans and if you talk to the military, their disappointment is a very understatement. And I think they're very, very worried about India's defense posture today.
Saikat, wonderful talking to you.
Pleasure.
To receive instant updates on all videos from The Wire, click the subscribe button and hit the bell icon. Pay to support independent journalism. Click the link in the description and choose the amount you want to pay.